Germany built a total of 1,162 U-boats during World War II. Of those, 785 were destroyed in battle or when at port. The remaining U-boats were either voluntarily surrendered to the Allies or deliberately scuttled at sea by either the Germans or Allies. Nevertheless, it is well documented that not every single U-boat has been accounted for. There are still those whose fates remain uncertain. These include those U-boats who are known to have been scuttled, but exactly where remains unknown. And then there are the three U-boats that were discovered entombed in a bunker on the Elbe River in the major port city of Hamburg. The fascinating story of the discovery, or to be more precise, the rediscovery of this trio of U-boats will be explored in this video. However, before we find out how the boats were rediscovered in 1985, we need to spend some time finding out about these three submarines and the bunker in which they were found. The three boats found in their so-called tomb on the Elbe River were U-2505, U-3004, and U-3506. All three were Type 21 U-boats, a larger, more powerful diesel-electric class of submarines built in the latter part of the Second World War, namely 1943 to 1945. As many as 1,170 of these submarines had been planned for construction, yet only 118 were actually completed. Coincidentally, this class of U-boat was highly influential in the post-war years. For example, its design formed the basis for what was dubbed the Greater Underwater Propulsion Power Program, or GUPPY, a series of improvements made to a range of different classes of submarines built by the United States Navy. The German U-boats also formed the blueprint for later Soviet submarine projects, as well as the Romeo and Ming classes of submarines built by the People's Republic of China. As for the three U-boats found entombed, they were all ordered in November 1943, albeit each was built by a different ship manufacturer. So U-2505 was built by Blohm and Voss of Hamburg, and U-3004 by A.G. Volkenstetten, in what was then the town of Stettin and today Szczecin in Poland, while U-3506 was built by Szczecin Werke in what was then Elbing and is today Elbląg, located in Poland. It should be noted that none of these three U-boats actually went out on patrol and into battle. Instead, all three were used as wartime training vessels. As with other U-boats of the same class, the three U-boats each measured just over 251 feet or 76.5 meters in length, with a displacement of 1,621 tons when surfaced and 1,819 tons submerged. All three boats were commissioned late in the war, with U-2505 commissioned in November 1944 and U-3004 and U-3506 commissioned in August and October of the same year, respectively. The bunker in which the U-boats were found was located in the westernmost pen of what was designated as Elbe 2. The principal function of Elbe 2 was to provide cover for Type 21 U-boats being fitted out. Elbe II was located within the Havelsberg dockyards on the south bank of the Elbe River, located just outside Germany's largest port city, Hamburg. The need to build bunkers for submarines in exposed locations had been a priority for Germany's high command since the very beginning of the war in 1939. Have you ever wanted to expand your World War II knowledge? Well, we have an exclusive community of like-minded individuals to enjoy and discuss history with. Just click the first link in the description or in the pinned comment to join. Thanks, and now let's get back to the story. Construction work for Elbe II began in late 1940 and was undertaken by the firm Dyckerhoff and Wiedemann AC. It was completed a few months later in March 1941. The bunker was impressive in its fortitude, courtesy of supporting walls made from around 1,765,733 cubic feet of reinforced concrete. The thick concrete provided a ceiling that had a thickness of 3 meters, or just below 10 feet. Its outer walls were a little less thick, but still a pretty steady 2.5 meters, or just over 8 feet in thickness. The result was a protective bunker, in the truest sense of the term. The bunker's sturdiness was also thanks to its foundation. It consisted of 2,500 piles driven into the notoriously tricky subsoil of Hamburg's harbor. Each pile measured 38 by 35 centimeters, or 13.7 to nearly 15 inches, with each having a load capacity of 60 tons. The bunker consisted of two wet pens, each of which 112 meters or 367 feet in length, and 22.5 meters or nearly 74 feet in width. These dimensions allowed for either pen to accommodate three U-boats moored side by side. Each pen housed a 3-ton overhead crane. There were plans to add six additional pens to the sides of the existing two, but this never occurred. The eastern side of the bunker housed offices and electrical workshops. The administrative spaces were all bomb-proof. The western section of the bunker provided storage space for machinery, building materials, and components. Above this was an upper floor composed entirely of workbenches and machinery needed to complete and fit out submarines, including vertical and horizontal boring machines, lathes, and drills. The entire workshop area totaled 1,800 square meters or 5,905 square feet. Entry into the bunker was limited to small, heavily fortified doors located on either side of the facility. Unsurprisingly, Elbe II and other bunkers at the Vulcan Yards were subject to repeated bombardment from Allied air raids. These rolling bombardments of the U-boat installations on the Elbe River had begun in July 1943 and intensified during early 1945. As the invading Allies upped the ante by attacking German infrastructure and installations. The bombardment of the Havelswerk yards on the Elbe River was astounding in its scale and ferocity. Over 450 Allied bombers dropped more than 2,200 tons of bombs on the yards during early 1945, devastating them to a huge degree. In just one night, that of March 8, 1945, more than 300 Royal Air Force bombers targeted the docks at Hamburg. Nearly 1,000 tons of explosives rained over the docks that night. Yet even so, the bunker at Elbe II remained relatively unscathed, with only its roof sustaining some limited damage. That damage was mostly due to a direct hit by a Tallboy bomb in March of 1945, causing the thick ceiling to bend only slightly. Another direct hit by an Allied bomb in early April did blow up the fortified steel doors on one side of the bunker. Even that major hit left the submarines moored inside undamaged. For the Germans, it was all over by early May 1945. Hitler was dead, and what was left of the Third Reich, now known as the Flensburg government, realized it had to surrender to the Allies. Almost immediately, the Allies demanded that the Germans hand over all their remaining U-boats intact. However, the Germans had made other plans even before their capitulation. Grand Admiral Karl Dönitz had taken over as President of Germany after the suicide of Hitler, and Dönitz was damned if he was going to just hand over his U-boats to the Allies. If you've watched our other videos on this channel, or know enough about Nazi Germany, then you'll know the name Karl Dönitz. Before becoming president, and before that, Grand Admiral, Dönitz had been the head of the U-boat division of the Germany Navy, or Kriegsmarine. The U-boats meant a lot to him, and that's why he enacted what was called Operation Regenbogen, or Operation Rainbow, on April 30, 1945. To know more about this operation, and its many twists and turns, be sure to check out the video we did on Operation Regenbogen. In short, the plan with Operation Regenbogen was to destroy or scuttle as many U-boats as possible before the Allies got them. One of the many exercises to carry out Operation Regenbogen was the scuttling of the five U-boats housed in Elbe II at that time. This would be done by the Germans with explosive charges. U-6, 8-4, and U-6-8-5 were both scuttled in the harbor in front of Elbe II. The other three U-boats, namely the U-2, 505, U-3004, and U-3506 of this story, were scuttled instead inside the pen by their own crews. Why these three U-boats were scuttled indoors, instead of in the harbor, like U-6-8-4 and U-6-8-5, is unknown. It was probably logistically easier to do so. For whatever reason, those three U-boats inside the pen were not destroyed to anywhere the same extent as the other two sunk in the harbor. It may have had a lot to do with how they were cramped inside a bunker, or perhaps their crews were just not that enthusiastic about blowing up their own submarines. The official end of the war came and went, and it was only on November 11th of 1945 that soldiers from Britain's Royal Engineers blew up the bunker at Elbe II. They did so using a stockpile of captured ordnance belonging to the German Luftwaffe. The central dividing wall between the two pens collapsed as a result of the massive explosion. The thick concrete ceiling gave way once its supporting wall toppled, thereby falling on top of and crushing U-3506. However, even with all of that, both U-2505 and U-3004 remained intact. Cut to 1985. That was the year in which Jack P. Malmanschauel, Wolfgang Hirschfeld, and Walter Klutz rediscovered the three U-boats in what was left of the mostly destroyed Elbe II bunker. The word rediscovered is used because the bunker and its three entombed U-boats had already been known to local authorities and some historians, as well as a few World War II treasure hunters and enthusiasts. Access to the bunker wasn't easy, but some people did still visit it from the 1950s onwards. The general assumption was that the three U-boats had been scuttled. The Hamburg authorities knew better, and they devised ways on how to remove the bunker and the submarines within it. Efforts to do so conclusively were eventually thwarted due to the logistics and prohibitive costs of doing so. Salvages on the subs did occur. For example, the remaining batteries, Junker compressors, and all copper cables were recovered from both U-2505 and U-3004 in 1950. While the sterns of both were blown off so that more materials could be salvaged. By the mid-1960s, new attempts to demolish what remained of Elbe II were considered in order to make space for shipping. A lot of concrete was removed, but an entire demolition didn't materialize because of, once again, the cost thereof. And so the trio of U-boats remained largely forgotten for another two decades. It was in late 1984 that Jack P. Malmanschauel became intrigued by the fate of the subs when doing research for his book, Hitler's U-Boat Bases. He had been asked to check it out by the Royal Navy's Submarine Museum, which was in possession of a large number of papers related to the Elbe II bunker. And so Malmanschauel undertook to inspect the ruins on the Elbe River at low tide in 1985. At his side was Wolfgang Hirschfeld, an ex-U-boat operator. They did so by invitation of the Hamburg-based Havaltswerke Deutsche Werft, or HDW, which owned the dockyards in which the Elbe II bunker was located. The company had known all about the bunker, but not taken it or its contents seriously, although it did guard the location. However, HDW closed its Hamburg yard at the end of 1985. That meant all the security and fencing around the bunker was removed, rendering the bunker vulnerable to relic hunters in the years thereafter. After all, it was now well known that three U-boats were still entombed in the derelict bunker. By 1995, the Hamburg authorities decided the fast-deteriorating bunker had to be destroyed once and for all. The cost of total demolition remained far too exorbitant, and so instead, the Elbe II bunker was filled in from the inside with sand. That operation commended on October 8th of 1995. Even then, the bunker still persevered. Attempts in June 2001 to destroy the bunker, this time with 226 dynamite charges, were once again a failure. The bunker's walls remained mostly intact, and the ceiling tiles didn't even budge. Not even 150 kilograms, or just over 330 pounds, of explosives could do the job. It was in the summer of 2003 that the remnants of Elbe II were completely covered in a layer of earth. Finally, all visual signs of the bunker disappeared. Today, its official location is below the container terminal Tollerort, or CTT, belonging to the company, HHLA, which is wholly owned by the Free City of Hamburg. Access to the area is off-limits. The three entombed U-boats were never recovered. All that remains of them is buried under tons of sand beneath a container terminal, or, as some sources believe, underneath a parking garage. Those three U-boats are lost to the world forever. Whatever one's feelings about U-boats and Germany's role in the Second World War, there's still something rather sad about that.